welcome once again to EWTN's Bookmark. I'm Doug Keck, your host. Our special guest author is Dan LeRoy, author of Liberty Lions, The Catholic Revolutionaries Who Established America, published by Sophia, available through the EWTN religious catalog, EWTNRC.com. Dan, it's a pleasure to meet you.
Doug, thank you for having me here.
And our audience may recognize you from having been on now with Father Mitch, kind of talking about this general topic. But you're an interesting historical personality yourself, let alone writing about history here, because you've written for some interesting newspapers and magazines over the years, haven't you?
Probably none more so than the late, not always lamented, Gene Simmons Tongue magazine. Had a short but glorious run. I was part of it, but it's also history.
Right, Village Voice you wrote for, yeah, right? I was going to say, some interesting things. Well, let me ask you, what brought you from that kind of world? And is that the kind of world you planned on spending your time writing in, music and things like that?
I probably always did. What brought me to this world, which is a little bit different, is being born Catholic, returning to the faith as an adult, and being lucky to be part of a parish in the Diocese of Pittsburgh, St. Monica and St. Blaise, which is run by a team of really incredible priests. It's a team of priests who are really bucking all the cultural tides. And in fact, one of those ways is that this book kind of came to be while I was lucky enough to be in the Perpetual Adoration Chapel at St. Monica, reading Magnificat and reading a column by a guy named Anthony Esselin, who writes a monthly column called How the Church Changed the World. So he wrote a column about Casimir Pulaski, who's mentioned in this book, the Polish revolutionary hero. And at the end of the column, he said, you know, there were some other Catholic revolutionaries who played pretty significant roles in the revolution. And so I was interested. I set out to read the book where I could find all these stories in one place, and it didn't exist. So if you're an author, you're always looking for an angle. What am I going to write about next? And this is what was next. So I hope I've managed to do a reasonable job of it.
Interesting. Now, in this book, and you go through that and the history and some of the names that, like you said, Pulaski, Kosciuszko comes up, Barry, other ones who were some well-known, some not as well-known. And it's funny also to mention like a Rochambeau or somebody on the French side, especially. I would think Degrassi probably was Catholic too, but
I'm
not positive.
He was.
Who was the admiral. But you start off with a very interesting approach, because you talk about Song of the South, and you talk about something, and I'll quote it. Today we remember the Stono River Slave Rebellion in 1739 as the only large-scale slave rebellion in the British North American colonies, as Hoffer describes it. It was also the first armed conflict in the New World between the British and Catholics demanding freedom. Where did you get that connection?
There are actually some scholars who have kind of paved that road for me, but the story behind it is that at least some of the slaves who were involved in this rebellion along the Stono River in South Carolina were Congolese, and they were Catholic. And there is a pretty strong supposition that part of this revolt had to do with venerating Mary. And the chapter tries to tackle some of the reasons for and against that. We don't have written records of it, so some of this is conjecture. But what is certain is that some of the slaves were Catholic, at least a few of them were educated, and the dates on which the rebellion happened seem to support this idea that it was some sort of Marian veneration that actually led the slaves to rise up at the time they did.
Right, and also because you're clear that throughout this we're dealing with a lot of anti-Catholicism and concern about not only as you get into the Revolutionary War period, anti-king, but anti-pope.
Absolutely. I mean, that's that theme, the idea of these divided loyalties, how can you be a good Englishman, a good American, if you also owe allegiance to Rome? I mean, we're still up against that in some ways today, I think.
Now, you go on in the section on the Song of the South, the reasons for Catholicism's southern tilt, and I'm going to ask you what do you mean by southern tilt, includes the fact that Maryland's southern colony with the southern agrarian economy was home to most colonial Catholics. We think of that as the kind of the Catholic colony, so to speak, at least historically. You said another factor was the presence of Jesuit-owned farms the major landholdings of American Catholics, which often employed slave labor, which we've heard a lot about in the last couple of years.
Yeah, well, I think having Maryland, as you just quoted there, be the significant Catholic outpost, and Maryland, you know, is in the colonies a southern state. Maryland is kind of what I was thinking of in making the case for that southern tilt. But Maryland is significant, I think, if we talk about Catholicism having a southern tilt, it's significant in another way as well, because Maryland is really the home of the intellectual underpinnings of the Revolution, and those intellectual underpinnings come from Catholics. And it comes from Maryland being a colony that's established by Catholics with the promise of religious liberty, which is not always lived up to. Sometimes it's a lot more theory than it actually...
And even in Maryland, it was interesting to see there was a lot more control of the church and worship than I think a lot of us kind of had an impression.
It's true, but what these Maryland...
went back and forth, as you indicate. Sometimes it wasn't so bad, other times it was worse, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And the fact that this history of sometimes being all right and sometimes not so all right has occurred, combined with this charter, which establishes Maryland as a colony that at least talks about religious freedom, is the thing that led Maryland Catholics to conclude very early on that they had become, by virtue of this charter and by virtue of their history, they'd become something separate from England. They were no longer conjoined. They were not just England transplanted geographically. And it's this realization that Maryland Catholics have, which is later embodied by Charles Carroll of Carrollton, the most significant of the Catholic founders. This is the thing that we find in the Declaration of Independence, those opening words when we say, when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the bonds because there's nothing that's holding us together anymore. That's something Maryland Catholics figured out a long time before anyone else.
One of the points you make here, which seems incredibly prescient for today, history can't be changed, but it can be examined. It ought to be studied in all of its complexity. When we do so, it should be with the acknowledgement that the lens we look through distorts the image.
Well, sometimes I'm fond of calling this book the Anti-1619 Project.
Okay, right.
And the fact is that the two things are kind of similar in some ways. They both deal with a fairly consistent historical period, and they both say things about this historical period that are a little bit contrary to what we believe. The difference is that the things that are said in this book are things that are based on research and fact and stuff that actually happened, whereas the central claim of the 1619 Project, which is that the colonists rose up in arms against the English because they wanted to preserve slavery, it's just not true. So that is, that kind of thinking underpins that quote about, you know, the way that we need to look at history, and we can't just look at it by today's standards. It doesn't mean we throw all our standards out the window. It doesn't mean we don't say
that. Contextualize it.
Exactly, exactly. And contextualize is becoming, as you know, a dirty word in a lot of places these days.
This was interesting. You pointed out that more than a few of the leading abolitionists who played a major role in ending slavery were also rabidly anti-Catholic. Some thought the two institutions, Catholicism and slavery, were equally evil. And you quoted an American Party broadside that was published just prior to the Civil War stated, Roman Catholicism and slavery are being alike founded and supported on the basis of ignorance and tyranny.
The thinking there is that Roman Catholicism, in the words of these abolitionists, it's just another form of slavery. It's mental slavery to Rome. You are essentially taking your marching orders from the Pope, and you have been enslaved in that way, the same way that slaves that the abolitionists are trying to free have been enslaved.
They're physically enslaved. They're
exactly
mentally enslaved. You say, this I thought was interesting, there are fascinating and illuminating paradoxes here, stories of great patriotism and also of human frailty, which is reality, right?
It is reality, and one of the truths that we can't elide here is that some of the characters who are very heroic in this book are also slaveholders, and Charles Carroll of Carrollton being the most significant, and we can't just sweep that under the rug. But also in this book are people like Thaddeus Kosciuszko, who was a fervent abolitionist, who his dying wish was that his good friend Thomas Jefferson would take all the money that Kosciuszko earned during the American Revolution and use it to free as many of Jefferson's slaves as possible, because he couldn't understand how Jefferson could write these words in the Declaration and be a slaveholder. And maybe fortunately for Kosciuszko, he didn't live to see Jefferson not live up to that pledge. But you definitely have both sides of the coin when it comes to this issue.
He's semi-well known because there's a bridge named after him, though it's mispronounced as Kosciuszko all the time, if you're familiar with the New York area, as well as the Pulaski Skyway. But
absolutely.
They're both in there. I thought this was interesting. First of all, you talk about the Quebec Act of 1774 and how the concerns were raised in the United States or in the colonies or the the fear of the Catholic Church in relation to Canada. And also, I mean, for somebody who's like the John Adams Chronicles, to see that, you know, John Adams was not a big supporter of Catholicism.
They were not. And in fact, you know, the responses to the Quebec Act really flushed a lot of the founders out into the open. On this side of the continuum, you have Alexander Hamilton, you have John Jay, you have Samuel Adams, you have guys who are pretty virulently anti-Catholic. If you move back this way, you have people like John Adams who are kind of puzzled by Catholicism. They don't understand it, and they make no bones about the fact they don't understand it. If you move farther this way, you have people like Benjamin Franklin, who at least are circumspect about whatever they really think about Catholicism, which leads people like John Adams to say, and I think it's quoted in the book, the Catholics thought he was a Catholic, the Quakers thought he was a Quaker. John Adams was very jealous of someone who could be all things to all people. But then at the other end of that continuum, you have George Washington, who's unlike any of the other founders in that respect.
Seemed very open in that particular way. It's also interesting that you talk about Joseph Warren from the Battle of Bunker Hill and Breed's Hill coming up earlier, and that Warren would be dead within a year. And you talk about he gave a document to a loyal silversmith named Paul Revere, who we know for another reason, basically to go to the Continental Congress, which was really designed to raising up the whole anti-Catholic aspect and our concerns about it, right?
This is the whole part about history and judging by the standards we have today. You know, there are a lot of founders who are heroic in every sense of the word, who also were anti-Catholic. It was the way they were. And I think we have to take them as they came. And we can't, on the basis of this thing or that thing, cancel them, throw them out. Paul Revere's a good example of that. Joseph Warren is a good example of that. These guys are heroic, and yet, you know, there's a section in here about Pope's Knights in the Northeast, in Boston. Paul Revere, we don't know whether he...
That's really the Guy Fawkes Day, isn't
it? Yeah, Guy Fawkes Day. And we don't know whether Paul Revere participated in the one that's mentioned in this book, but he probably would have liked to if he could have.
Didn't you have two competing groups in there? The
you
north
did,
side
the north, and north End and South End, and they had different popes, which they would try to capture the other side's pope. Mm-hmm. You know, Pope's Night sounds like a fun Catholic event. In fact, it's this excuse to get drunk and burn the pope in effigy and really indulge in public anti-Catholicism. And George Washington, speaking of people who were different than all the other founders, George Washington, when he takes over the Continental Army in 1775, one of the first things he does is says, we got to knock this off.
Right.
We cannot ask our fellow citizens who are Catholics to participate in this cause if we're going to insult them publicly in this way. And Catholics never forgot that that was something that he did.
Well, it's interesting. You make the point. What makes this vehement anti-Catholicism all the more stunning is that during colonial period, Catholics represented a little more than 1% of the American population. I also think it's interesting because you're claiming that that these Liberty Lions were major players in the founding of the country at the same time, when they really were a very small part of the population.
Well, the numbers tell you two things. The numbers will tell you that 24 to 30,000 Catholics lived in the Revolutionary era. And that is, like you say, it's less than 2% of the total population. So on that basis, it's kind of easy to understand why people would say Catholics. How important could they have been? But among those Catholics, you have not just people who are patriots, but you have people who are leaders militarily, economically, which is a really big thing that we underrate sometimes. You know, wars don't get fought for nothing. You have guys who are leaders intellectually, and then, of course, you have leaders spiritually who are keeping the faith alive at a time when Catholics are being persecuted in America. But then the other number that never gets talked about is when you factor in these foreign contributions from the French, from the Spanish, from the Polish, from the Irish and the Germans. There's a number that suggests that as many as 70% of the troops who fought on the side of independence were Catholic.
Right. I thought that was a really interesting point you made. You said that consider the estimate that 70% of all Allied troops were Catholic. Not an impossible number if you add in the French, the Spanish, as well as the Irish and German Americans. And throughout the book, such counterfactual arguments were necessary to make a larger point. And then you jump to, in a sense, the scripture, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Why did you put that in there?
That was actually going to be the name of the book before we came up with this more this shorter and more alliterative title. The Stone the Builders Rejected was the first title that I came up with because that was Catholics in the Revolutionary era. They were the stone that nobody had no use for them. Mm-hmm. Catholics in this time cannot worship publicly really anywhere except Philadelphia. They can't hold office. They can't vote. It doesn't matter if they have as much money as Charles Carroll, maybe the richest guy in America, still a second-class citizen all the way. But this stone, through the if we look at it as stone being represented by the guys in this book, the stone becomes a cornerstone. And when we say that the revolution is intellectually Catholic, that's part of it, too. Catholics play a much more significant role than just what the numbers might first suggest.
Right. Now, when you're talking about, and also Kosciuszko, because I'm used to singing or Pulaski, they came over from Poland. And obviously the French came over as well, Lafayette, except Rochambeau, which you mentioned there as well, being involved. So some of that is also the fact that people who decided to come over and join the fight.
They did. That's one of the things. You go as far back as the Revolution, and these foreign contributions to American independence have been downplayed. And you can see that in part because some of the people, like Beaumarchais, who put up a lot of his own money for the revolutionary cause, they never got it back.
Right.
So even in those days, you can understand why that would be. It doesn't make for quite as sexy a story if you say that, yes, we actually got our independence because largely through the efforts of foreigners who also happen to be Catholics. But that's what happened.
Yeah, that's a good point. Chapter 3, the Pope who helped the Patriots. You talk about a Pope, Clement the 14th, and the suppression of the Society of Jesus. I wonder if you go into this with Father Mitch, of course, but the idea of even saying that that had an impact on the status of the Catholic Church in America. How so?
It absolutely did. And one of the ways that it had an effect is that a lot of the characters in this book, Father John Carroll, Charles Carroll of Carrollton's cousin, who became later the first Catholic bishop and then first Catholic archbishop in America, but also people, also Jesuits like Father Ferdinand Farmer and Father Pierre Gibault on the Western frontier. These are all guys who were circuit riding priests who were taking not only the faith to their parishioners, but they're also taking the patriot cause to their parishioners. And this is something that the suppression of the Society of Jesus freed them to do because they had no link at this time with London. They were kind of free agents in a sense. Had the Society of Jesus still been in existence and not been suppressed, it's hard to tell whether these guys would have had the latitude to do what they did in taking this message of independence to all of the many, many people that they served.
You talk about a man of few words. You say there's a third Carroll among the founders. He is a mystery man of the famous Carroll trio that includes his brother John and their cousin Charles. Although he's the least known of three Carrolls, the few words for which Daniel Carroll is best known have made his impact on America just as significant as his more famous relatives. In fact, he was involved with being, one of only five men to both sign the Articles of Confederation and the Constitution.
Absolutely. And he plays a pretty significant role in having the president selected by the people, which we do. That was a contribution made by Daniel Carroll at the Constitutional Convention. So even though we don't know a lot about him, or certainly not as much as Charles Carroll and John Carroll, his brother, he definitely had a very outsized impact. So in that sense, maybe he's representative of all the Catholics in this book who really punched above their weight, I think we would say, just in terms of their historical impact.
You also talk about here about, I'll let you pronounce his name, Beaumarchais, as you mentioned before. It was interesting because he created The Barber of Seville and The Marriage of Figaro, the comedies that were adapted into the operas, right?
Yeah, he was he made his name in theater, but he was also a very ardent revolutionary, and he was a big believer in the patriot cause. And Beaumarchais is the guy who really convinces the French to start getting involved in the revolutionary process covertly by funneling arms and supplies to the patriots. And in fact, it's kind of a circular thing. You know, the French want to stay out of this until the patriots show that they can actually be trusted to win a significant battle.
Right.
So the significant battle that they win is at Saratoga.
Saratoga, right.
But that battle doesn't get won without the supplies from Beaumarchais.
You make that point because it's a famous battle. Henry Gates defeats a gentleman, Johnny Burgoyne, a incredible defeat for the British. But you say the army helped win the decisive battle had already been outfitted and supplied by the French.
Circular reasoning there.
So you had, and you talk a little bit about that. You also talk about the Pulaski's first military duty, the Battle of Brandywine Creek. Now, Brandywine did not work out so well for...
It was bad, and it would have been a lot worse had Pulaski not entered the scene and kind of did this rear guard action, which he led with this band of cavalry that he kind of rounded up on the spot. Mm-hmm. And he did just enough of a covering action to allow George Washington to exit the battlefield, because Washington was about to be captured. And if Washington's captured, well,
it's basically all over.
Yeah, we're not having this conversation today. So right from the beginning, he had just come over and he kind of wowed everybody with his horseback riding prowess. It's why he became known later as the father of the American
cavalry. Right?
His first big thing is saving Washington's bacon.
Right. It's interesting because he pushed the concept of guerrilla cavalry, which they didn't buy into, and they probably should have.
They said it's one really, if you want to look for a shortcoming of Washington's, that might be it. Washington really was not persuaded of this idea that Pulaski had, which was that you can do a small, light force, you can go in and run incursions and really do a lot of damage that way without sustaining a lot of damage yourself. They didn't really, as you say, they didn't buy into it. And who knows how things would have gone, but I guess ultimately will take them the way they turned out.
So in your reading of Kosciuszko, they talk about him, he literally would give you the shirt off his back.
Well, the sculpture of Jefferson that we're all familiar with, the Jefferson Memorial, he's wearing a fur coat, and that fur coat actually came from Kosciuszko. It was one of the gifts that he gave. He was one of those guys, as you say, who would give anybody anything. Mm-hmm. And the ironic thing, I suppose, about it is that he gave Jefferson this gift, and this gift has been immortalized for all of us. We see it every time we visit the Jefferson Memorial. Mm-hmm. And yet, like we were saying a little bit earlier, that relationship, which was very, very close, Jefferson begged Kosciuszko to come to America to live with him. When he couldn't persuade him to do that, he said, look, you should come here and could at least be buried by one another. He really looked at him as a very, very close friend. Kosciuszko only wanted one thing, free your slaves. I'm going to give you the money to do it. And Jefferson, after Kosciuszko died, said, it's too complicated. I don't think I can figure this out. I'm going to let the courts settle it, which they did, and ultimately the slaves got sold.
And he was an engineer. In fact, you give him credit, I'm assuming others do as well, for the American success as well at Saratoga because of his engineering skills.
Absolutely, and Kosciuszko's big success, I think, is West Point. He gives Washington
this
impregnable fortress along the Hudson that he's wanted for a long time, because the Hudson is the key between the northern and southern theaters, and West Point is the thing that kind of secures it for the Patriots, and that's Kosciuszko's doing.
And you make the point that you believe if he had stayed there, and that the Benedict Arnold thing would not have probably happened.
I don't think so, because Kosciuszko had left, and I think he would have been aware of what was going on, because Arnold essentially shooed everybody else out and said, listen, I'll take care of everything, when what he was doing was making copies of the plans to turn over, and we all know how that turned out.
So you got some other ones in here, obviously, almost the father of the American Navy is in there as well. So
absolutely.
In that way, there is a lot of fathers. I have to get one question just before we go. Who is God's Johnny Appleseed?
That's Father Ferdinand Farmer, who was a Jesuit circuit rider. He made probably the biggest circuit of any of them. They all had a lot of territory to cover. But Ferdinand Farmer, he lived in the saddle, he died in the saddle, and he served places well beyond Philadelphia, where he was headquartered. He went to New Jersey, he went to New York, where the order was essentially shoot priests on sight. This is a guy who performed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of weddings and baptisms, and who brought the faith, and who also brought the patriot cause to innumerable people throughout a very wide swath of territory.
That's right. Good to know our history, maybe strengthen our resolve. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks,
appreciate
Dan. Dan LeRoy, author of Liberty's Lions, the Catholic Revolutionaries Who Established America. Sophia Institute Press, available through our EWTN religious catalog, EWTNRC.com. A very interesting read. Check it out, and check us out next time right here on Bookmark. Thanks.